Hi, everyone. Aaron here for zollotech, and iOS 14.5 Beta 1 has been out for almost a couple weeks at this point, and I've been using it full time. Now, Apple released iOS 14.5 Beta 1 to developers, then a few days after that released iOS 14.5 Beta 1 re-release to not only developers, but also to public beta testers. And so I've been using that version full time, and I think we can expect iOS 14.5 Beta 2 very soon. I'll talk about that a little bit later, as well as a possible public release as well. But before we talk about any of those, I wanted to cover a few more features that are pretty major in this update that I didn't cover before that people have uncovered and I've found as well. And so the first one is you can set a default music app now. Now you can't see this physically to toggle it yet, but if you go into settings, for example, and you were to scroll down to music, generally there would be a toggle to select whatever music app you would want. Currently in beta 1, it's not there, but the first time you use Siri using the assistant to activate playing music, for example, it will ask you what app you want to play it in. Now I've already done that on both of these devices, so it won't pop up that way, but let me show you what it looks like. So the first time you toggle it, it will pop up. And this is a shot from Mac Rumors. And then also if you ask it to play music now, you can select whatever music app you want. So let me hold the power sleep wake button. You could also activate Siri using the word hey in front of the assistant. So let's go ahead and try it. Play Awake and Alive by Skillet. And we'll wait for it. And you'll see it's already playing in Spotify. Now, like I said, you can select whatever you want as your default just by asking. So now let's try it in Apple Music. Play Awake and Alive by Skillet in Apple Music. And you'll see now it's playing in Apple Music and it shows it in the upper left. And this goes for anything you might have, whether that be Tidal or Pandora, for example, you could do the same. So you'll have to select it, give it access to data so that it can do that, and then you'll be able to play it in whatever you want. So hopefully we'll have that toggle in the music app, or in the music settings rather, in the future. So hopefully we'll see that soon. Now, Apple Maps has been updated as well to allow for crowdsourced data, similar to Waze, for example. So if we go into Maps, now, if you set up directions in Apple Maps, maybe you want to go to Charleston like I have here. In the bottom right, if you're driving along your way, you now have the option to report. You can report an accident, a hazard, or a speed check, and you can use Siri to do this as well. So you now have the option to report. You can report whatever you'd like, and then you could clear it a little bit later, and that will give users anonymous data nearby if there's something going on. It doesn't report your data directly, so you can give users a heads up if there's an accident, hazard, or speed check. Now with Safari, Apple's doing more to give our privacy priority. So if we go into settings, we go down to Safari and then go down to privacy and security, you'll see we have fraudulent website warning. So we have some new options there, as well as them blocking additional cross-site tracking. So we have those features, which we know about with iOS 14, for example, but also they're now directing safe browsing traffic in Safari through Apple servers instead of Google to protect personal user data. So Apple's going above and beyond here to protect our data. And all of this will be active very soon when iOS 14.5 is available to the public. So I can't wait to have that active, and there's just more and more that Apple keeps doing. However, with iOS 14.5, it's been okay for me so far with the overall use of it. So I wanted to talk about my experience with it since I've been using it on the iPhone 12 Pro Max, the iPhone 11 that I have here, as well as the iPad Pro 12.9 from 2020. That's my main device when I'm not editing video. And so the overall experience has been pretty good for me. It still has that stutter when you open music or any other app and swipe out, and it's hard to reproduce on video for some reason, but it does show up where you swipe out and it sort of stutters away. So that definitely has returned, and I can't get it to go away without rebooting. Then it will show up about a day later or so. So that's something that I still see, but the performance for me has been fine. I've had no slowdowns. The phone has not been getting unusually warm for me, although some people did report it in the community poll, which we'll take a look at in a little bit. But the overall use of it has been pretty good. I had additional issues with Bluetooth with the first version of the beta, then they re-released it, and it's since been better. So unlocking my car, for example, it's been great with that. I haven't had any issues since the re-release. What Apple did in that re-release, I'm not sure, but they seem to have fixed any Bluetooth issues I was having. However, there's a bunch of issues that are being reported by you in the community poll still. So the green tint issue, I covered this in a video the other day where it's still an issue. Apple did fix it in August of last year for iOS 14 or iOS 13.6.1 for iPhone 11 series phones, 11 Pro and 11 Pro Max. And they did fix it. So I expect them to fix it in this update, whether it be this one or a future update. I do expect them to be able to fix it with an update. Also, people are reporting blurry images when sending through iMessage if you're in low quality mode. So it's more blurry than normal. Even if you're not in low quality mode, sometimes those images are not coming through in the high quality that we expect. Also, I'm finding that things like AirDrop can be slow from time to time. So when you're sending a file, a photo, or something to another device, sometimes it's unusually slow. And it's stuck there. There we go. There was an error there. You saw a little freeze up, and there are some freeze ups and lag throughout the OS. Not only swiping away, say, an app, but going into settings, sometimes it will just sort of lock up. And I've talked about that before as well. And some people are having apps crash. The PlayStation app is working now because PlayStation updated it, but some people are having app crashes as well and other issues. So there's definitely a ways to go. This is the first beta, and so I would expect another beta eventually. And also, if you're having issues, make sure you report that in feedback, as that's very valuable. Now, before we talk about when to expect the next versions and battery life, let's take a look at the iPad, because like I said, I've been using this full time. So my iPad Pro is one of my favorite devices, and I have to say that the experience on this, other than one thing, has been really good. I haven't had any of the lag, the slowdowns, the stuttering, or anything like that. No issues with the keyboard, thankfully, and it's been really solid, with the exception of battery life. And I've continued to talk about this, and battery life does not seem to improve much on these versions for me. And so as you can see, it was last charged to 100% yesterday at 9:18 a.m. And in that amount of time, if we look at yesterday, I used it 2 hours and 46 minutes and had 2 hours and 14 minutes of screen off time. And with those times, so 3 to 4 hours of usage, I'm down to 34% battery. Now, the screen has been on for the video, and that will affect it a little bit, but getting less than half of the expected battery life is no good, and I would expect them to improve this, of course, with future updates. But so far on the iPad, battery hasn't been great. However, on the iPhone, it's actually been okay for me. So I know it's not great for everyone, and it is a beta, so there is that. But if we go into settings and go down to battery, my battery health is still at 100% on this phone, my iPhone 12 Pro Max. And if we look at the last 10 days, say yesterday, for example, I had 4 hours and 1 minute of screen on time, 43 minutes of screen off time, and used just under 50% of my battery. So let's say 45, 48%. So that would give me 8 to 10 hours of screen on time and screen off time combined. And then if we look at the day before, again, 3.5 hours or 3 hours and 28 minutes of screen on time, 3 hours and 1 minute of screen off time, playing music usually, and I used about 35 to 40% of the battery. So in general, 8 to 10 hours is what I'm seeing on an early beta. That's actually a good sign. As you can see, the day before that, I only used four hours of battery life and, or screen on time rather, and got 80% of my battery used up at that. So it's doing much better than it did the previous days. It sort of improved the last few days for me, and it seems to be okay. What it is specifically that improved, I'm not sure, but I just keep my apps updated, and that's all I've changed. Now, as far as iOS 14.5 beta 2, like I said, I think we're on a 2 week cycle, and based on that, I would expect it, well, as soon as Monday, which is an unusual day. So usually Tuesday to Thursday, but Apple has not specified a day, but we're on a 2 week cycle. And if they release it, well, 2 weeks from the other one, expect it on Thursday, but generally it's at the beginning of the week. Apple has not stated when it will be though. But one thing I'm waiting for is a public release, iOS 14.4.1 or whatever they call it, iOS 14.4.5. And the reason I say that is Apple stopped signing iOS 14.3 a week or so ago. Generally, after they stop signing a previous version of 14.3, leaving only one public version available, we'll have a public release within 2 weeks based on what they've done in the past. So this coming week, I would expect a public release and a beta, unless they decide to do the crazy thing they did a couple of weeks back and release iOS 14.5 to the public, which I would not expect since it has quite a few bugs. So hopefully we'll see a public release and a beta release this week. And if we do, of course, I'll keep you updated on YouTube and other places as well. Now, as far as the YouTube community poll, well, since the previous poll, there has been a ton of votes and more than I would have ever expected, 40,000 plus votes and over 340 comments, with 17% of you saying that iOS 14.5 beta 1 is great, 3% saying it's terrible, 7% still having bugs with it, which I think many people are, 62% of you not updating yet, and 11% using Android. This number was 10%, it increased a little bit. And like I said in the previous video, if you have any ideas of what we think we could kind of refine these into that would be more helpful, let me know in the comments below. So I think this update is good for a first beta, but not great. But let's go ahead and take a look at a few of the comments. Now, I sorted these by newest first since I read some of the older ones before. So let's go ahead and take a look at these. Jasmine Matthews says, I can no longer use my two Bluetooth keyboards. This is a very huge issue for me. I use them 98% of the time. I'm using iPhone 8. If you're talking about the beta, then you may want to downgrade to iOS 14.4. But if you're on iOS 14.4, unfortunately, you'll have to wait for a public release in order for that to be fixed. So hopefully it's the beta and you can just simply downgrade. Josie Romero, your tech curator, says, I'm using the iPhone 12 Pro Max and I've had so many weird glitches occurring since I updated to 14.5 beta 1, including my phone completely freezing and I could not hard reset or anything. Finally had to plug it into iTunes, and once it finally restarted, it logged me out of every single app on my phone. Tyler Charlton said, 14.5 has been by far the best beta for me on my iPhone XR. Great battery, little to no bugs, notifications working well, and few new features to boot. Great for me so far. iPhone 12 Pro, only issue is no MagSafe animation. And that still hasn't returned, so that's definitely a bug. Well, Fredo Nanita says, iPhone XS here. It's been great on version 1. The watch unlocked my iPhone twice without me wearing a mask or even looking at the phone. I reported the issue and Apple replied, sending me a link to download a certificate to the watch in case the issue comes back using the new beta version. Version 2 has been better in this regard. So far, the watch has only unlocked the iPhone when I'm wearing a mask and I'm looking at the phone. Austin says, iOS 14.5 is awesome on my iPhone 12 Pro Max. The only issue I have with stutter when I swipe out of an app, but restarting fixes the issue for a while. Other than that, the update is great. Edward Valiz says, for the first time ever since I own an iPhone, I'm having a lot of Bluetooth and data connection problems. Weirdest thing ever, iPhone 12 Pro. See, Brandon's Lawn and Landscape said, the battery is incredible on my 11 Pro Max and 12.9-inch iPad. I would love to see when they put more widgets in it, I think is what he's saying. And then finally, using 14.5 on my SE 2020, and it's been doing great. And so this particular update, like I said, is a little old at this point, and I can't wait to see what we have with beta 2, for example, as well as maybe a public release to fix some major issues. But let me know what you like best about iOS 14.5, what you would like to see fixed first. I'd love to hear from you in the comments below. And again, make sure you're reporting feedback if you're a beta tester or developer. If you'd like to get your hands on this wallpaper, of course, I'll link it in the description like I normally do. And if you haven't subscribed already, please subscribe. And if you enjoyed the video, please give it a like. As always, thanks for watching. This is Aaron. I'll see you next time.